When you first assemble every scene, all the words are there, but the nuances of those words aren't there yet. And you have to go in faith that that material is there, that the meaning is there to be had. It's just a question of going and finding every single syllable, if it has to be, of every word, every little nuance that the actor does, and infusing and having them really own what they're saying. I mean, that's really the thing, is when a character is owning their words, if what they're saying has the force of their own feeling behind it, then you know you're getting there.
It's interesting with David's work. It's aggressive, and with that it has a sort of modern quality to it, but yet it's very strict rules. It's old-fashioned, almost Hitchcockian-style rules. We never cross the line. We rarely ever cut straight in. We're always doing basic film lore, but it can just be done extremely rapidly. The opening face smash scene, that worked at its best when it was fast. At first, there was that tendency to going, oh, is everything landing? Is everybody hearing everything? Is everything perfect? But it's so much information about blogging. People don't need all that information. So the faster you got, the better it got. And David does a lot of setups. So you can be anywhere you need to be, but it's still always by that sort of strict filmic law.
He shot, I think, 268 hours of material. And our job is to take the very best pieces of that and reduce it down to the best, hopefully less than 2 hours.
If we're going around a deposition table and there's, you know, six players, you can be, if you want to be on a certain person for a certain line, you know you've got that angle.
I think the thing we're going to key off of is this fight here that has to happen here. So I think we're looking for the three-quarter for all of this stuff with Jesse foreground. So I also think that it works for this, for the over-the-shoulder, to, we can see that Andrew's gotten up and left. So if we do that, that necessitates the Tyler Divya triumvirate, and then single.
And if you then want to cross over to someone's reaction from it, you've got their shot from where you last were.
Then we'll move in, clean that up. Then we'll move in, clean that up, and then we'll come back around. All right.
Cool.
Okay.
When you first watch dailies, the stuff comes in, and from take to take to take to take, it doesn't look any different.
So when all the dailies come in, it's kind of like a, you know, it lands like a plate of spaghetti, and you're like, what?
And then you start to really look at the minute sections of each take, and you compare them against one another, and you start to see that they are quite different.
85 Denver, take one.
And there are little, tiny, subtle gems of performance which rise to the top.
Do you see any of your code on Facebook?
Sorry.
Do you see any of your code on Facebook? Do you see any of your code on Facebook? Do you see any of your code on Facebook? Do you see any of your code on Facebook?
Sai, could you?
Mark.
Wait, did I use any of your code?
You used our idea.
Fellas.
Match.com for Harvard, guys.
Can I continue?
You know, you really don't need a forensics team to get to the bottom of this. If you guys were the inventors of Facebook, you'd have invented Facebook. If you guys were the inventors of Facebook, you'd have invented Facebook. If you guys were the inventors of Facebook, you'd have invented Facebook.
Fellas.
Match.com for Harvard, guys.
Can I continue with my deposition?
You know, you really don't need a forensics team to get to the bottom of this. If you guys were the inventors of Facebook, you'd have invented Facebook.
You have to just choose a path, and you can get to the end, then you can judge and sort of go, okay, but we can enhance it by being here, or we can enhance it by... But there's always somewhere to go. You're never fixing something. You're always helping something.
You do the best you can during production. You have to rough cut the scenes as they're shooting them. So you have to keep up, which is insanely challenging on a movie like this, because they're shooting, I mean, it's just so many words a day and so many takes of so many words a day. So just getting through everything and putting something, assembling a scene, even though it's just sort of the meat and potatoes of the scene, it's the nuts and bolts, it's just the words, it's not even the best performances, that's more than a full-time job. So by the end of production, our goal is always to have an assembled, it's not good, but there's an assembled rough cut. And it's funny because on this one, it was actually shorter than the final movie, which is very unusual. It was, I think, an hour 56, but it was really flat because basically it was the nuances weren't there, the performances weren't there. We actually had to blow time into it because we were sort of racing over meaning too quickly.
Sorry, can you please repeat the question?
No, it was an outrageously leading question the first time around, and now you're going to have us hear it twice?
Exactly the way I'd have it in front of a sold-out courtroom. Right, Marilyn?
It's really hard to make those final choices. I mean, for instance, the scene when Eduardo tells Mark that I was your only friend. Those performances were really, really emotional, and there were tears.
I was your only friend. You had one friend. I was your only friend, man. You had one friend. I was your only friend. You had one friend. My father won't look at me.
And we worked with those performances, and we kind of, you know, when you cut a movie, you fine cut generally from the beginning. And when we got to that section, it just seemed like it was the wrong note for Eduardo's performance right there. So what we realized is that has to be the absolute most muted performance because the emotion is inherent in what he's saying.
I was your only friend. You had one friend.
I mean, of all the scenes in the movie, that was kind of the most interesting in terms of really finding what that performance was supposed to be. I think everybody thought it was going to be one thing. But watching it now, I don't think it could have been anything else.
It's quite comforting once you first sort of learn with David. There's never a that'll do kind of approach to working. And you could put a scene together for the first time and David will watch it and be like, great. That doesn't mean that's done. That means, great, let's put our attention to some other problem that needs attention, but we're going back there.
At the beginning, he gives you sort of big picture direction. It's like, this is what the scene should feel like. This is what the scene's about. And then once you start cobbling it together and you have this thing that's sort of working, like all the words are there, but it's not, the meaning hasn't been really brought out of all the performances, then he starts to drill in and you start to really look at the specifics.
Like, no scene's ever really locked. And he would just hit you with questions. Is that the best line of that? Is that the best line of that? The chicken line, it's funny. Let's try it in a close-up. He's blinking at the part of that. Let's do it. Yeah, and then you would start going through looking for words within takes. And then you'll start towards the end looking for syllables within words.
What's challenging for us was that David might choose a take visually that he liked, but then he'd want to choose a different audio take and match that. And then within the audio take, he'd want to choose different words that he felt were the best performances. So a lot of the performance that you hear is, there, of course, it's the actors, but stitched together from different dialogue reads.
Ren is loved and adored with Finch's core. There's a core kind of group of us that are always working together. And Ren's, he's more than just the sound designer. He's the sonic kind of guru. And he's going to be involved with everything sound, with the music, with the dialogue, the sound design, all things kind of like come and pass through Ren's filter. There was a moment in the corridor where you've got Eduardo whining about why Sean Parker's been setting up meetings everywhere, and there's the response coming from Zuckerberg, I need you here, I need you here, don't tell the others I said that. But there's a gap just before, don't tell the others I said that. Ren takes that gap, pops in like a big toaster oven that's buzzing in the outside as if they've just finished their sort of crap frozen pizza. And everybody going, hey!
The energy. Mark, you got it. I'm afraid if you don't come out here, you're going to get left behind. I need you out here. Please don't tell them I said that.
What did you just say?
So just the fact that you hear a bunch of sound motivates, don't tell the others I said that. So it's not just sort of, oh, I see them doing this, I'm going to put a sound on it. He's always sprinkling in pieces of sound to help character. And it's not being asked for or sought after, it's more like he's looking for opportunities.
Did you know there are more people with genius IQs living in China than there are people of any kind living in the United States?
That can't possibly be true.
It is.
What would account for that?
Well, first, an awful lot of people live in China, but here's my question. How do you distinguish yourself in a population of people who all got 1600 on their SATs?
What David wanted to maintain constantly throughout this film was the sense of really actually being in the environment.
I could grow crew or invent a $25 PC.
Or you get into a final club.
Or I get into a final club.
So he wanted to hear every nuance of Sorkin's precious dialogue, which is key, particularly in the opening sequence where the script sets up all the bits and pieces of the film later on. So it's key dialogue. And yet David wanted to have all of this happen in this noisy environment where you're just barely able to hear what they're saying. And he wanted to create a sense of youth, you know. He goes, this is a place where, you know, they're serving $3 beers, man. You know, it's got to be noisy. You know, so we went to Boston, we snuck into bars, and we collected all these noises, and then we kind of tried to make a tapestry in between all the dialogue. When you're mixing sound for film, there's a tendency to kind of go, okay, let's pull all that crap down and make sure the dialogue is nice and clear so that we can hear everything. And that's sort of your first position. And David Fincher would come in and say, I don't like that. It sounds too much like a, you know, stage play. It sounds too much like a film. I want it to sound like real life. And bring up the noise, bring up the noise.
No, I was just hitting your glass.
Background in action.
Did you know there are more people with genius IQs living in China than there are people of any kind living in the United States?
That can't possibly be true.
It is.
What would account for that?
Well, first, an awful lot of people live in China, but here's my question. How do you distinguish yourself in a population of people who all got 1600 on their SATs?
I didn't know they take SATs in China.
They don't. I wasn't talking about China anymore. I was talking about me.
You got 1600?
Yes, I could sing in an a cappella group, but I can't sing.
Does that mean you actually got nothing?
I think perhaps it sounding bad is actually makes the film edgy and makes it interesting for the audience because it really sucks them into like, okay, hold on, you're going to really have to pay attention here.
You're breaking up with me?
You are going to introduce me to people I wouldn't normally have the chance to meet. What is that supposed to mean?
Wait, settle down.
What is it supposed to mean?
Erica, the reason we're able to sit here and drink right now is because you used to sleep with the door guy.
The door guy, his name is Bobby. I have not slept with the door guy. The door guy is a friend of mine, and he's a perfectly good class of people. And what part of Long Island are you from? Wimbledon?
Wait.
I'm going back to my door.
Wait, is this real?
Yes.
Okay, then wait, I apologize, okay?
We were able to sort of define these beats where we, you know, for example, you'll watch that scene, and right as Erica says,
it'll be because you're an asshole.
And she gets up and leaves him. All of a sudden, the sound pressure of the bar's environment dissipates as those words land to Mark. And this lonely tone sort of creeps in. And so there's a change in the soundtrack. Even though we're still in this place, the soundtrack propels us into what he's feeling. In terms of sound effects, you know, there's a trend in films now to make a sound effect every time there's a computer. And, you know, you see it all the time in science fiction. You see it all the time in a James Bond film and a Bourne Identity film. Is and it's all this kind of business, and it's very technological. And we talked about that. And we thought, well, let's do our version of that. But what does it really sound like? Well, it sounds like hard drives chirping, and it sounds like motors fanning, and it sounds like the rapid fire of keystrokes. And so we went more realistic. And I think it's appropriate for the film because having noises that aren't part of reality, I think, would actually diminish the credibility that the film's trying to achieve. We spent a lot of time we went to Boston, onto the Harvard campus, and we collected classroom noises. Some hallway ambiences. Dormitory ambiences. All of those little specific sounds we tried to weave through as well to create a sense of place and a sense of time.
Everything that we do and everything that we did in post is really in service of the story and to sort of disappear into the story and make any sort of artifice disappear as a result. So as a viewer, the goal is that you're immersed in the movie. I mean, there's certain movies that I go to that I just get lost in, and hopefully, I mean, that's always what you hope for whenever you make a movie, is that it's one of those movies.